voir ces trucs en saison 8 aussi.
Ah oui, c'est bien de les voir en saison 8.
Ça change.
I see a plant that I know since many years in literature, and actually I know it is quite common in Africa, but I did never see it. It's a Costus spectabilis. It's very interesting because it has usually four leaves totally oppressed to the ground, and moreover we see that not only these leaves are oppressed to the ground, but also they can cover any element. So it's a really what is called a tigmotropism. It means that the leaf is able to have any deformation and to take any shape of the support. We see clearly here it was a wooden piece just under the leaf, and so the leaf did cover and turn around this small wooden piece. So it's really interesting to see this phenomenon. Ooh, something strange here. What could it be? Leaves are a little bit like chlorophytum leaves, but very, very thick. What it could be on three-carpellate fruits? Maybe it's a chlorophytum totally oppressed to the ground, exactly similar to the Costus, which is growing just a few centimeters away. Oh, we see the flowers! Okay, so flowers are very chlorophytum-like. I could never imagine that some chlorophytum species were able to grow like this, totally oppressed to the ground. So we see the small white flowers. Also the leaf is very beautiful, it's velvety. So it's a shaded place, but we cannot speak of a deep shaded understory, but it's a shaded place. So very, very interesting.
So here we can see, of course, quite many interesting plants. The common taka, of course, this is one thing. Here, something looking like ginger. Probably it is a ginger. These leaves are the bright green leaves, are the leaves of a Haemonthus, the group Haemonthus scadoxus, probably a scadoxus. And here we can see the fruits of this Haemonthus scadoxus. So we see each stem during the rainy season produces some leaves, four, five leaves, and an inflorescence. And now it is the season of the setting fruits, and we see that it likes really to live in rock crevices. And it shares the habitat also with a member of the Araceae family. It's probably a Styloceton, genus of Araceae, poorly known from Africa. So as soon as there are rocks, we can see there are many interesting plants. Of course, there is a so beautiful purple Thunbergia, a climbing Thunbergia with long hanging flowers. So we see in a very short area, we can see many interesting plants.
Oui, it's a small Dorstenia growing in the rocks in the same way as many Dorstenia, and we see the characteristic fruits. Oh. So it was ripe, probably the seeds already were expulsed. So we see all the filaments on the periphery, it's like an open fig. It's a very beautiful species. I'm very intrigued by this small plant with one leaf. The leaf is spotted, same as many understory plants. So here I try to see how is the base, and I see that the base is a tuberous base. We see the small tuber with only one leaf, a perfectly orbicular leaf. I don't know at all what this could be.
We see again this costus from Savannah, and we clearly see the phenomenon again of stigmotropism. We see when the leaves are oppressed are along the ground, they are oppressed to the ground, but as soon as there is an obstacle, like this piece of wood, the leaf is totally covering, almost adhering to the piece of wood, or it could be a stone. A good strategy for this species growing in very open places, because the leaves are pressed to the ground, cover the grasses which could grow. So they keep enough space, free space, due to the fact that the leaves are covering the grasses and other plants on the ground or the any obstacle.
We can see a layer of the grape family, but this is an erect and not climbing species. We see the old stems, so it means that the stems are annual stems appearing in the rainy season, and we can see the inflorescence typical of the Vitaceae, the grape family. But I did never see this type of layer with so big leaves. I'm very surprised. I see this little conifer, but it's not at all, of course, a conifer. We are only at 1,000 meters above sea level, close to the Lake Tanganyika in these mountains, and it's an asparagus, but it's very strange to see these perfectly displayed lateral branches. It looks more like a dicot than a monocot. It's very, very elegant to see these successive levels, like different crowns with very narrow cladodes, because of course it's not leaves, because it's an asparagus, so it's a narrow stem. So the fruit is amazing. Incredible. It's probably part of the fruit opening, and the seed with areola is protruding out very sexually, and probably it will attract some animals. So now we're at 1,400 meters above sea level in these mountains parallel to the Lake Tanganyika, and I see this very strange thing with totally glaucous leaves, a little bit dentate. I see the swollen nodes and this inflorescence, and I think it's also a Lea species in the Vitaceae, but a very, very strange species with so glaucous thick leaves, maybe due to the altitude, because we are quite high now in this range, but I'm sure this area has not been much explored by botanists, because in the ancient time during German and English, there were no access at all in this area for the Lake Tanganyika. So I think that maybe many of the plants we can see here are maybe not very well documented, and maybe not so many herbarium specimens are existing in the world. On the Lupita Island, which is a small island on the coast of the Lake Tanganyika, on the Tanzanian side, of course. It's south of the Mahale Mountains, and this small island is very well preserved, and we can see quite many interesting plants. And here, I see a euphorbia. I can detect it's an euphorbia due to the shape of the stem of the leaves, but actually the leaves are incredibly strange, totally bifurcate at the top. It's a triangular global shape, but the end is totally truncated, totally irregular. And what is interesting is that the vines of the leaves don't bifurcate at the end into the two lobes of the leaf, but actually it's along the midrib that the lateral very light green vines emerge on each side of the leaf. So it's of course very, very elegant. We see also the undulations along the leaf. I've never seen this euphorbia. Maybe it's quite common in East Africa, but I did never see it in neither in South Africa or Malawi or other places. So happy, a little bit rain, because it's rainy season now.
Elle est très claire, hein?
The gloriosa are always very strange, because each individual that you see has a different pattern. So we see that this one is very, very bright yellow, and it has a very distinctive purple patch at the top of the inner side of each tepal. Of course, the inner side becomes an outer side for the view, because each tepal, of course, recurves when the flower is opening, and after it is fading a quite dark purple. So we have all of these quite strange differences between the bright yellow young stage and even green. And here we can see the stamens perfectly exerted. And here the bright yellow pollen emerging from the stamen. So we are now along the shore of the Lake Tanganyika at the small Likoma Island, which is very well preserved. We have seen many interesting species, for instance, a very rare Euphorbia species, Euphorbia bis elegans, very beautiful spatulate leaf shapes. And here now we are swimming inside the Lake Tanganyika to look at the so many cichlids. And of course, it's a dream. We see, for instance, the small Eretmodus with the dark small body and the so bright design, vermiculite design, bright blue. It's incredibly beautiful. Many Trophaeus and group of the Trophaeus, some with very beautiful vertical stripes, either yellow or bright orange. We see many fish of the Julidochromis alliance, but probably many of them are not Julidochromis, but other genera. Also, many of the Lamprologus group, like very black ones with just a little blue liseré. So these fish of the Lake Tanganyika are very, very elegant. And actually, contrary to the Lake Nyasa, the Lake Malawi, where there is only one group of cichlids which have all the breeding habit, mouse breeding habit. So it's one group of cichlids. And in Lake Tanganyika, there are two groups, the same group as in Lake Nyasa, with also mouse breeding made by the female, so the Trophaeus group,
and also all the Lamprologus group, which has all the Neolamprologus, all these fish, all along this lake. And of course, in the deep water here, I speak just about what happens in between a few centimeters and 2 meters. But of course, if we should go a little bit more deep, we should see many, many other type of species. And of course, impossible to reach the 800 deep meters of the Lake Tanganyika, which is one of the deepest, of the second deepest of the world. Quite exceptional plant, mostly known from Ruaha area, so it means about 200 kilometers from here. It has so beautiful leaves, very beautiful shape, and this is a euphorbia. This elegans, probably simply because it was first described as Monadenia elegans, and we see all the lateral branches. And we see that the trunk becomes quite thick, and what is interesting, it has very beautiful golden peeling bark. And when we move downward, we see that this bark is totally exfoliated, and it's this individual is really quite a huge individual, because it is supposed not to be more than 2.5 or 3 meters, so it's probably one of the highest individuals we can see. It seems really that when we closely look at each lateral branch, we see that only the last part, about 10 centimeters, are bearing the leaves. And this last 10 centimeter stem is pure green, and just below, no leaves, and the bark is dark. So it means that this species most probably is deciduous. So during the dry season, probably there is only the stem, and during each rainy season, we can see all these new apical part of the shoots bearing the leaves. And of course, there are some lateral stems emerging from the plagiotropic branches, because the branches, lateral branches, are totally horizontal and plagiotropic, in spite of the fact that the phyllotaxy is totally a spiral phyllotaxy, but the branches are really growing horizontally and even growing more or less downwards according to the main stem. It's a little bit like an araucaria in the conifers, but of course it's totally different. So this species seems to be not common at all. Ils sont bien accompagnés. Une fesse bleue, une fesse verte.
I'm very surprised because in the Katavi National Park I did see something white. I did think from far it was a crinum, but no, it's an hypomea, it's a morning glory, a shrubby morning glory with huge white flowers, really a huge species. According to the flower size, I think I did maybe never see such a huge size for a morning glory flower. Of course, it is a nocturnal species. It is night blooming because we see that now it's about 10 in the morning and it is already totally fading. So all these flowers are opening at night. This one is probably for tonight. This one was yesterday. This one last night and probably this one tomorrow. But what also it is important, I did look, but it's not a shrubby species. I did think it was shrubby, but actually, when I look at the stems are totally green and herbaceous. So probably it's one of these species with a big rootstock, and every rainy season, new stems arise from the basal rootstock. So all these stems are growing in all directions from the center. I have never seen such a huge flower for hypomea, for morning glories. And here also something probably also night blooming. Of course, we know with the leaves like a butterfly like this, of course, we see it's a bohinia. Oh, so sweet smell. Oh la la, typical of a night blooming flowers, so beautiful with the white petals and the red stamens, but also there are some other insects. There are many tsetse flies here, so we have to be a little bit careful, but no problem. we look at this shrubby bohinia with so beautiful white flowers. Here we can really understand the growth habit of this hypomea, I think. Now I see it totally developed, and according to the shape of the leaves and the size, I think maybe it's a hypomea verbascoidea. It means looking like a verbascum. Here we see the stems of last year, totally dry, and the new stems of the year arising from the base of the plant. Of course, the beautiful flowers, totally white with a dark red, purplish center. So just one season living stems. And here we see the dry capsular fruits, typical of many hypomeas. I just look if some seeds are still inside. No, nothing. I'm surprised because just on the opposite side, I see something orange and something red. These are flowers, but what is this? So, first, this orange. But it's another bohinia. I'm almost sure. Wow, a climbing bohinia. The color of the flower is incredible. It's not salmon, not pink, not orange, not yellow. It's a kind of mix of everything. The ants seem to like it. Of course, this is an Asteraceae, but once we say Asteraceae, we say almost nothing. Of course, daisy family, but the color actually is so strange for the eyes. It's totally saturating the eye. I see also it's coming out from a base, two stems, so it's, of course, it's not an annual plant. It is also coming out from a rootstock during the rainy season. We see here a Dioscorea with huge leaves, huge trifoliate leaves, but and it has also a spiny stem. It's already flowering. We see the inflorescence here. So it has probably the tuber inside the soil, because we see two, three stems arising from the same base. So it's a not high climbing species, but it's interesting to see that it is flowering so close to the soil for a Dioscorea. So here on this slope, we see a taka. I know there are taka in Africa, but it's surprising because it really seems to be very closely related to taka leontopetaloides, which we know very well when usually growing quite close to the sea in sandy soils. It has the long filaments, the bracteal filaments, typical of this group of taka. It has bracts, upwards bracts, and I'm more surprised to see these four upwards bracts in this group of taka. We see the flowers not yet open, because of course all the other elements are not flowers but bracts. These filiform bracts and these foliaceous bracts. And we see the leaf, so the leaf is actually very small, same as inflorescence for Taka ilontopetaloides. So I don't know if it's another species or if it can be considered as a form or as a variety of a Taka ilontopetaloides. I'll see this a little bit later, and I think I did see also some fruits here in fructescence. We see so the fruits, developing fruits, not yet mature, but developing. It's a berry-like fruit, for is the same for most Taka species, except one from Asia, a small one, which has dry fruits, but this will be a fleshy fruit. The petiole is very beautiful. It is vertically striped, white and dark green. Not yet open flower. Oh, we see all the center with stick, remove all the tepals, and thus we can see the center of the flower, perfect with stamens and stigmatic surfaces. By the Katavi National Park, and here during the rainy season we can see many plants arising from the soil, either annual or with tuber, and emerging. For instance, here, not yet flowering, but obviously it's a member of Malvaceae. But here I see a beautiful small Hypomea, which has a leaf blade palmate. It's nice with the involucral bracts at the base of the flower tube. And here's something else, very, very strange. I did think, when I did see the yellow orange flower, I did think it was a Thunbergia, but when I did look, I did see that leaves were alternate and not opposite. And most surprisingly, I did see tendril, so I did immediately think it was not a member of Acanthaceae, but a member of cucurbitaceae. But what is very exceptional is that the flower emerges not from the leaf axil, but directly from the junction between the petiole and the leaf blade. It emerges here just in the center of the leaf. We see the shape, the ovary, the big ovary of the flower, and the beautifully shaped lobes of the corolla and the tube. And when we see younger stages, we see clearly the flower bud emerging from the center of the leaf on all these leaves. Each leaf has a flower emerging from the center. So not so many plants are like this. It's why I'm very surprised, because I know, of course, some species with flowers emerging from the leaf, but not so common. And actually, I did see a smaller flower and not so deeply lobed, so I was a little bit intrigued. And I see that actually it's the two different sexes. The big one, which is most common, with the very beautiful dark purple sepals, is the male flower. We can see inside all the stamens inside the flower, the group of stamens just here. So this is the male flower, and the other one is totally different, because we see the stigma of the pistil emerging in the center of the flower, the greenish little dome here with a style which is very narrow, and the inferior ovary, this small green cylinder, and the pistil at the top. So it is it has separate sexes, and I think it is dioecious. Probably there are male and female individuals, which is something, the separation of sexes is usual in the family Cucurbitaceae. But it's always a pleasure to see really the difference in the shape of the flower. Really, it's a good season for the plants, a small thing. I don't know at all what this could be. It has alternate leaves. I don't know, but it has very beautifully shaped star flowers, tiny star flowers with lobes. It is secondiflor, because all the flowers are appearing on the same side of the axis, but it's very, very beautiful. I cannot now give a name, but I think it will be quite easy to find the name. Also, this is a beautiful, I don't remember the name, but I know the family. It has alternate leaves, and the shape of the flower really like mini Scrophulariaceae, but if I quite remember, it's another small family, not far from Scrophulariaceae, but a different family. So, just in 1 square meter, we can see quite many interesting things. We move a little bit forward. So here in the savannah, we see all these erect
leaves of ginger. It's very similar to many curcuma leaves in Southeast Asia. But when I see the flower, it's obviously not curcuma, because the structure of the inflorescence is different from the structure of curcuma, and the flower is incredibly beautiful. The labellum, the huge labellum, is in three parts, and it has a perfect bright yellow design on the dark purple. It's really a very, very strong contrast. We see all the pieces of the sepals around the corolla of the flower. The bracts are around, and here we see also another part of the corolla, another small petal. But obviously, the only showy thing is this huge labellum of the flower. It's a gladiolus. I see this incredible, beautiful orange flower just above the ginger around. And it is obviously one of the many species of gladiolus in East and South Africa. And the color is really astonishing. And we see the different color according to the different types of tepals, and it is absolutely perfect. So it's a species with the leaves and the flowers appearing during the rainy season. I think this is not a borassus, but a hyphene. And we see all the congested fruits on the inflorescence. And we can see it's probably dioecious, because we see some individuals wearing all the fruits. And just after, we can see another individual with very thin inflorescences with many lateral branches. And obviously, these are male inflorescences, so it is probably a dioecious palm, a female and a male just behind. Ricinus communis at home along the river close to hippopotamus. In the savannah,
we did see this quite tall flowering spike, and from far I did not know if it could be a gladiolus, it could be a malvaceae, it could be an orchid, but finally, when looking closely, it is an orchid, a terrestrial orchid, which has incredibly beautiful leaves. I see it's an orchid, first of all, because I see the fruit, and I see that the fruit actually is the peduncle of the flower. Here we see the flower, and the peduncle of the flower actually is the ovary, same as in all orchids, the ovary actually maintains the flower far from the main stem. So we see it is an orchid. I don't know, of course, which genus. It looks, it's funny because it really looks like a Scrophulariaceae or this kind of family, and not especially like an orchid, but it is. The leaves are quite nothing special, more or less Liliaceus-like leaves, quite many orchids, terrestrial orchids of this kind of leaves, somewhat plicate. So we see the labellum, the main petal, and the two other petals above. And all what is real sexuality is in this structure above. So there is a pistil, and just under, the darker spots are actually the stamens, and usually the insects are coming inside and the stamens are fixed on the head. And what is funny is that just under we see something exactly looking like yellow stamens. These are two horns, little, very, very little horns here, which are not at all stamens. It's simply protuberance on the lower part of the labellum, and it's probably a kind of artifact for the visual artifact for the insect, thinking that the stamens are here, but actually it's just some emergencies of the labellum.
Yo adoro, Juan y Guiter, Juan Ganeo, Adonde, Godiamo.